The Doctor enters the console room from one of the many corridor entrances. He began to walk up the stairs towards the console.
So, how do I look?
He reached the top of the stairs and did a little spin on the platform.
I thought the backwards spacesuit and lab coat mashup wasn't that practical for something to wear, let alone comfortable.
The Doctor was wearing a dark blue poncho with a hood which is outlined in red. Dangling down from the hood are long drawstrings. As well as this, a purple shirt with small white dots on it is barely showing by the V-neck in the poncho. The shirt's top button is undone. He is also wearing slim-fitting blue jeans as well as grey and blue shoes with odd socks.
I'm glad you like it. I will be honest. These were just the first clothes I saw in the wardrobe. I never really got a good look at myself. I was thinking too much about this problem over here.
He walked over to the whiteboard, covered in scrawly handwriting. It had the words Bad Wolf written in giant capital letters in the centre of the whiteboard.
Have you worked anything out yet? Anything at all? Really? Nothing? This must be almost impossible to solve then. It just doesn't make sense how it would take me 10 months to fall to Earth. Hang on a second.
He runs over to the console and presses a small blue button. The doors open and he runs towards them to get a look outside. Outside was a view of the Earth from above, rotating in the magnificent way that it does.
Damn! No atmospheric discoloration. So it's not the atmosphere causing the issue. I really thought it would be a temporal bubble, you know, the ones that knit themselves into the atmosphere, creating a bubble around the targeted planet. Oh, do you remember the Zygons did that? Wasn't it such a pain to get rid of? Sorry, yes, I'm getting distracted. Back to work now.
He closes the door, stumped once more. He looks at the whiteboard.
No matter how many calculations and theories I do, it doesn't get me anywhere near to a suitable conclusion to this strangeness.
He looks at the whiteboard for a bit longer before turning away from it towards the console.
I really wanted to look cool and impressive when I met Skye again. But because I don't have the answer to this strange problem, I can't do that. Let's just go and meet her. One thing she has over us is time. She's had months to think of an answer to this problem, even if she has only got a human brain.
The Doctor pulls a large lever and the TARDIS begins to fly faster. He presses other buttons and switches.
I hope she's able to travel with me. You're great and all, old girl, but you can't actually walk around with me. You don't have a face I can talk to. I just feel lonely. Thank you for that. I was half expecting you to get annoyed at me for saying that. Yeah, I know. I should know you a bit better by now. Oh, wait, hang on. I have an idea for this problem. Can you take the wheel for a bit? I want to check this theory through. Thanks.
He leaves the console and looks at the whiteboard. Buttons and levers press by themselves.
Well, that wouldn't make sense. No, because of that. This is so frustrating. Can you shut up? I'm onto something here. So, how about this? Yes! And this? No. What did I tell you? Shush, I need to concentrate. Okay then, this is right. No.
The Doctor is suddenly flung forward into the whiteboard, smudging all of his work. There is a bang noise from outside.
What was that for? Right, you better not do that again. I need to get this sorted, alright?
There is a large bank outside the Tardis, and the Doctor begins to get flung all over the Tardis, hitting every surface on his new interior.
Ow! Turn on the ow, stabilizers.
The shaking stopped. The Doctor fell down to the console platform.
Yes. I'm fine. What about you? Good.
He gets up, grabbing onto the console as he does so.
What the hell was that?
The Doctor pulls his body up using the console until he is standing up. He leans on the console and slides the monitor around so that he can see the reading on the screen.
Alright, okay. No external damage, which is good. You're a tough girl, aren't you? Let's just scan the area. I doubt there's anything there because we're in the time vortex, but it's worth a look.
The Doctor presses a few buttons and something else appears on the monitor. It showed the TARDIS inside the rainbow time vortex. It was floating above something that contrasted greatly with it.
What the hell is that? It's not.
The Doctor presses a few buttons and something overlays over the diagram of the time vortex. It was a text box which read, "External scan complete. High danger level. Black hole detected."
A black hole? In the time vortex? What? I've never heard of such a thing. Have I just discovered something? Oh, how exciting. It's definitely more exciting than my discovery of that new type of mold that grows on blue cheese. Wait, so you're struggling to keep us out of the black hole. Why didn't you just tell me you were fighting against it? I mean, there's nothing we can do, is there? Let it take us in. Maybe we get lucky, and it's a wormhole instead of a black hole. But we can't find out until we go in, can we? Don't worry, we've been through worse. Remember that time when... you know what? Forget the references. Just go in already.
After a few seconds, the Doctor saw that on the monitor, the TARDIS was starting to sink into the black hole.
Good. Well done, old girl. Now we just cross our fingers and hope.
Blackness started seeping through on the edges of the monitor screens. After a few seconds, it had turned completely black. The Doctor jumped in happiness.
And... we're in. And guess what? Nothing bad has happened.
Suddenly, the whole interior of the TARDIS started to shake and the liquid inside the time rotor began to bubble once more. The Doctor was flung off the console platform and he landed on the sofa below. Before sliding along the floor towards the bookshelf, he then flew up in the air as the TARDIS dropped to the deep unknown of the black hole. This whole time, the Doctor felt like his entire body was being squeezed from all angles. This flying around the TARDIS and squeezing sensation went on for a few minutes before finally decreasing in severity. The shaking then finally stopped, and the TARDIS was flying like it was before. The Doctor fell down to the floor, near the corridor doors. He stayed lying there, his skin extremely pale.
I'm okay. Just feeling a little.
He covered his mouth as it filled with his stomach's contents. Suddenly, a bucket fell down from the ceiling and landed next to him with a clang. He took the opportunity to spit out the acidic substance into the bucket.
Thanks, old girl. You.
The doctor leaned over the bucket once more and began to fill it up again.
Oh, you really know what I want. Thanks. Oh, I see. You didn't do that out of kindness, but to stop me from messing up your floor with my sick. How gracious of you.
The doctor slowly stumbled up, carrying the bucket with him as he staggered back up the stairs for what felt like the 10th time. As he got to the top of the stairs, he started to collapse, but leaned on the console. He looked at the monitor once more. It was still completely black. He put the bucket on the ground.
Where are we? I can't see anything.
The doctor listens out for the TARDIS's reply, but gets nothing.
Hey, where are...
Suddenly, a small white dot begins to appear in the center of the monitor. The doctor notices it and watches it as it grows larger and larger.
Ah, we're still in the black hole. Well, technically it's a wormhole since it has it on the side, but really not a smooth one. I give that wormhole a 2 out of 10. If only there were a website for wormhole reviews. There seems to be a website for everything else, so why not that? Sorry, I'll stop rambling. I know you're concentrating.
The doctor waited in silence as the white dot slowly grew into the scenery of space. In it, the center of this view was an orange ship. It had a white stripe running down the center of it.
Hey, could you do a scan of that ship? Maybe give me a bit more info about it before I go in.
Suddenly, something popped up on the monitor. The doctor read through it.
The HS Transmission. A delivery ship made and maintained by the peoples of New Earth. Blah 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 blah. It's made in 5343. Wow, that's old, isn't it? I mean, it's 5792 now, isn't it? This whole time travelling stuff can get real confusing. Well, it looks okay for now. Why don't we land in there and have a look around? Can't stay cooped up in here like this, just observing from a distance. We'd look like cowards. Although, there's nothing wrong with them.
The doctor pulled a lever and the TARDIS began to land. It landed and the whirlpool in the center of the console deformed and eventually disappeared. The doctor began to walk towards the door. He felt his pocket, making sure he hadn't forgotten before he went out.
Oh, my sonic. Is it ready yet? I kind of need it just in case.
Something shot out of the console. Sticking out of it was the doctor's new sonic. He pulled it out of the port on the console, revealing the entire structure of it. There was a blue tube at the top of the sonic. Inside of it shined a bright blue light where the doctor pressed the yellow button. Around the tube were small green LEDs embedded into the tube's structure. Around the tube was a red heptagonal cage which connected to the tube light extremely loosely. When the doctor pressed a trigger at the back of the sonic's handle, the three-sided cage began to spin. The green LEDs and clusters of the tube began to flash in a sequence, from bottom to top. This was the sonic's scan mode. Further down the sonic was a thin gold ring, and below that was a screen. It curved around the circumference of the sonic,
showing strange symbols native to the Doctor. The Doctor turned the gold ring, changing the symbols that appeared on the screen, almost as if he was changing the Sonic's mode. Below the screen was the Sonic's handle. This is where the button and trigger were placed. The handle was a dark blue and had minuscule shining silver pieces of glitter littered around the Sonic, giving the effect of a sparkling night sky. The handle was shaped to be ergonomic in the Doctor's hands. Below this was a metal cap. It was ribbed and had the same ergonomic shape as the handle, except it was much smaller. This was where the Sonic could get charge from the TARDIS or more easily transfer files into it. The Doctor turned it over in his hands, excited about this new gadget.
Okay. This is amazing. You just don't stop astounding me. First this insanely beautiful console room, and now this new amazing Sonic. He's even got a new button. Thank you.
He gestured towards the trigger of the Sonic.
Oh, and sorry for breaking the other one. Anyways, back to work.
He began to walk towards the door. The bucket slid towards where the Doctor was going. The bucket knocked into the Doctor's legs, and he looked down at it, still full of stomach acid.
Huh? No, I'm feeling better. I don't need it. Oh, I see. You don't want it to create a smell in here, do you? Fine.
The Doctor picked up the bucket.
I'll take it. I don't know what I'll do with it, though.
The Doctor opened the door to a small room. He stepped out into its messiness.
Oh, it's always cupboards, isn't it? Why do you always park in a cupboard? Have a bit of class. Yeah, whatever. Next time try and park in a better spot. It gets a bit boring constantly having to walk through mops, cleaning products, and random bits of cardboard.
After the Doctor had scrambled over the rubbish-filled room, he found himself in a brightly lit corridor.
Ah, this is better.
He takes a look around.
A delivery ship with no one on it. Shouldn't there be plenty of people on board right now, you know, preparing for the next planet's deliveries? I should see loads of people running through this corridor, unless they do things differently in the 58th century. Oh, I haven't spent enough time in this time zone.
The Doctor begins to walk down the corridor, Sonic and Bucket still in hand. Every time he passes a doorway, he looks into it in search of people, but instead just finds each of the rooms empty.
Such a large ship and so few people. Something's definitely up.
Out of the corner of his eye, the Doctor notices something move behind him at the other end of the corridor. He turns to see who's there, but instead just sees a leg disappear around the corner.
Wait!
He puts the bucket over his shoulder and begins to chase the person.
Okay. Legs? Extremely good for running. Good to know.
The Doctor makes it to the end of the corridor and turns the corner to another stretch of the corridor.
They're also very good for control. Not bad for back to front legs.
He sees the other person. They had stopped and were leaning against the white wall of the corridor, trying to catch their breath. They look up, noticing the Doctor, and start to run again.
Hang on. I just want to talk.
The Doctor carries on chasing them. They seem to be going a lot slower than the Doctor was, so the Doctor was quickly gaining on them. When they got to the end of the corridor, the Doctor and this other person were centimeters from each other. Suddenly, the person opened the door and ran inside, closing and locking the door behind them. The Doctor ran into the door, hitting his face.
How about my legs control? Scratch that. They don't like to stop.
The doctor looked into the room through a small circular window. He saw a group of people crowded into the corner. The person the doctor was chasing joined them.
Hey, let me in. I won't hurt you.
None of the people moved.
Great. Guess this is as good a time as ever to try this baby out.
He puts the sonic to the door and presses the yellow button. The blue light begins to shine out of it. After a few presses and flashes of the sonic, the door clicks open and the doctor walks in.
Could use a little calibration. I mean, it's new after all.
As he walks in, the people looked at him with frightened eyes. They get closer together as a group. Everyone in the group wore the same uniform. Brown life jacket looking shirt with orange baggy trousers. The person the doctor was chasing seemed to be a young boy, maybe between the ages of 10 and 11. His clothes were the baggiest of all the groups. Then there were two other boys, older than him. One of them looked to be in their early 20s, but had the oldest looking eyes the doctor had seen. The other male seemed to be in his 30s, along with the person in the centre of the group. The only female there. She seemed the most calm out of everyone.
Hey there. I won't hurt you.
One of the people, the one in the centre of the group, pointed at the door with a shaking hand. The doctor looked at the door. It was wide open.
Oh, you want the door closed? Yeah, I can do that here.
He closes the door. The person lowers their hand. The doctor walks over to the group and kneels down.
So then, what are all of you doing here? Shouldn't you be preparing for your next delivery?
The group looked at each other.
We were...
Oh, I could hear a butt coming.
Something happened.
What happened?
The group looked at each other again.
People began to go missing. We just thought they were hiding to get away from doing work, but...
But then everyone started to disappear. They would be there one day and the next they would be gone, almost like they had disappeared overnight.
Interesting. Do you know what caused this?
Yes.
Go on.
You see him over there?
She pointed to the youngest of all of them.
He's the oldest of all of us.
Well, he clearly isn't. I mean, look at him.
I'm 63.
No, you're like 12.
He's 63. I knew everyone on the ship, and I know that's Bob.
Bob. Kind of average name. Anyway, how about this one then?
He points at the second youngest of the group.
Mark?
Yeah. If I had to guess, he's extremely old. I mean, look at those eyes. They have definitely seen a lot.
No, nothing has happened to him.
The doctor stands. He begins to pace around the room. He stops.
Nope. Pacing really annoys me now.
He sits on a table.
So, okay, let me get this straight. You think that people are being made younger by something, and that's causing them to disappear.
Exactly.
And this Mark person here definitely hasn't been exposed to this something.
Definitely not. Have you?
Me? Why?
Like Mark here, your eyes look so old yet you look so young. You look like 16, 17 years old.
No. Not that young, right? No.
He runs over to a mirror on the wall. He sees his face. He touches it with his hand to make sure it is his. It was incredibly smooth, not a wrinkle in sight. His hair is brown and wavy, his forehead covered in spots. He had extremely long eyelashes and dark blue eyes. His nose and mouth looked about average size and shape. His jawline was quite sharp, but not incredibly. He lifted up his hair to show his ears. They were small and extremely flexible. The group slowly walked over to him.
Oh my god, no, no. I've been turned into some team. This is awful. Yeah, I should have checked the mirror before I went out.
He turns to the group. He grabs Mark and pulls him towards the mirror with him.
What do you think? Do you think I have a load of spots? Oh god, wouldn't that be bad?
Sorry, who are you? Are you the rescue crew?
Well, not really a crew, but yes, that's if you want rescuing.
So this is a supply food?
The doctor turns to see the oldest male look into the bucket of the doctor's sick. They began to stick their hand into the bucket. The doctor ran over and took the bucket.
Nope, don't touch that. It's fertilizer.
For what? There aren't any plants here.
I was... gardening before I got into scratch school. That's it. Gardening.
Strange.
Anyways, can everyone tell me their names? Just so I don't forget. I have a feeling I'm really bad at remembering names this time.
This time?
I'll start. Hello, I'm the doctor, here to rescue you.
The doctor places a sick bucket on a table near the mirror. Mark holds his head in pain.
You okay?
Yeah, sorry. I get a lot of headaches. I'm Mark, by the way.
Mark, the one that gets headaches. Right, that's written down in my mind. How about you?
Me? I'm Tim.
I need something to remember you by.
I think you're pretty strange.
Tim, the one who thinks I'm pretty strange. That's written down. Hang on a sec. Hey!
I'm Bob. I'm 63, but I look like 10-year-old.
Okay, and you?
I'm Jessie. Just trying to keep calm and keep safe.
Okay, great. This makes things a lot easier now that we have all the names. So then, I guess we should start by working out what this something is that's causing everyone to grow younger. You, Bob, you must have seen it. What did it look like?
Well...
Suddenly, Bob's eyes grow wide. They are staring behind the doctor.
Bob, stay with me. We need this info.
It's
what, Bob?
Bob lifts up his hand, shaking intensely.
There?
The doctor follows the finger and sees something on the other side of the room. It was long and thin and was black in coloration. In some parts of the body, there were random small triangles, all of different colors. It swam through the air, floating towards the group.
Oh, what do we have here?
What are you doing?
Don't worry.
The doctor stops and leans towards the creature, trying to get his sonic as close as possible without going near it himself. He turns the sonic on and it begins to buzz. This buzzing seemed louder since everyone else was so quiet and on edge. The creature turns its head towards the sound. It swam quickly towards it. The doctor moved his arm out of the way, stopping the sonic from buzzing as he did so. The creature swam into the wall, its body going through it.
Well, that was useful, wasn't it?
You could have got us all killed!
Yeah, you're right there. But guess what? We're all still alive. And we have valuable information. Tell me, what did we learn?
That we're facing off against a giant slug.
No. More important than that.
That it wants to kill us?
Not necessarily, Bob.
I have no clue.
Fine. Mark, please tell me you got it.
I'm guessing it can't see.
Okay. Why'd you guess that?
If it could see, it would have gone straight for us. Instead, it followed the sound of your thing.
Great investigation work. A star for you.
What does that mean?
It's the highest grade in English colleges in the 21st century. Anyway, we're getting off topic. This thing can't see. So all we need to do is get to the TARDIS without it hearing us.
The TARDIS?
Oh, hang on.
The doctor looks at the sonic. On the screen, it is showing some more symbols in the strange writing.
Ah. Now that would make sense.
What is it?
It's a temporal.
What does that mean?
Basically, it's a parasite. It travels through the time vortex detecting ancient lives, then it creates a wormhole inside the time vortex and goes to the ancient life. And then it feasts on all the years that creature has lived, slowly making it younger and younger until nothing. They do look completely different from when I saw them last. They must have mutated.
Sorry, I'm a little confused. So these things hunt for living things which are really old, right?
Yes, ancient, like hundreds of thousands of years old.
Why target this ship then? The oldest person we had here was... Jessie, your help?
78. The oldest was 78.
Oh. You are good. Why didn't I think of that? Maybe they were following something, but it got away? Making wormholes in a time vortex uses up a lot of energy. So maybe they just got tired from chasing and decided here was the best place to go because of quantity over quality.
Or maybe there's something on the ship which is really old.
That would be me.
No, I think he's talking about the bulk order of live goods in the storage house.
You think there might be something extremely old there?
Just a hunch, but yeah.
So then, this TARDIS?
It's my ship. It's the thing that's going to get us out of here.
If this thing is attracted to age, then shouldn't we have a distraction?
Well, if we can find the thing in the storage house, then that'll be the distraction.
Why not just skip the middleman and use you? You said you're really old, didn't you? How old are you exactly?
That's a question. Hang on. 800 as well. 4,400 years old by this point. Probably less. But I'll give you a nice round number.
There we go. Our destruction.
Hang on a minute.
You would be perfect.
There's a slight issue.
And what's that?
My ship. She won't let you take off without me. Sorry.
Great. Perfect. So we're going to have to find another distraction then.
Just in case we do get caught? Yes, that would be a good idea. We have no idea how many of them are out there.
So is that our plan then?
Yep. And you'll know how to get to the storage house where these live goods are kept?
Everyone turns to Tim. He looks back at everyone, extremely frightened.
I do.
Then you can lead us there.
What?
It's okay. I've been running all over this ship, and I've only seen one in all the time I've been here. You'll be fine.
Tim walks over to the door and looks through the small, circular window.
Does that explain this then?
Everyone else looks outside and sees a whole swarm of temporals outside.
Ah, they must have heard us talking.
So what do you expect us to do then?
Keep to the plan. Just stay quiet.
So you're saying we have to go through those things without making a single sound?
Shh. Only for the meantime. This corridor is just one long stretch, isn't it?
Yeah. So what?
The doctor reaches within his poncho and replaces his Sonic with a wind-up mouse.
Perfect.
The group slowly exits the room, the doctor leading, holding his toy mouse tightly to stop it from making any noises. Everyone is incredibly quiet. There is the occasional swishing sound of a temporal changing direction in the air. Everyone in the group had now exited the room and all were in a line, backs against the end wall of the corridor. They were all crouching low down. The doctor looked back at the group and nodded. He placed the mouse on the ground and suddenly let go. The mouse began racing down the corridor, squeaking as it did so. The temporals all suddenly turned in the direction of the mouse. There were many strange and ear-piercing cries coming from them as they suddenly darted down the corridor after the mouse. After a few seconds, sighs of relief were heard from those in the group. They began to get up.
Great work, everyone. It should be plain sailing from here.
Suddenly, another, smaller temporal swung through the wall behind them.
going straight through Tim. It made a wispy popping noise as it entered and exited Tim's body. The temporal swam off down the corridor to join the others of its kind. Tim fell to the floor. The doctor rushed over.
Oh.
Tim, are you okay?
You should have just kept your trap shut for a little longer, Doc. Then this wouldn't have happened to Tim.
How was I to know that there was another one?
Suddenly, the wispy popping noise re-emerged as Tim began to shrink. He suddenly got younger.
Oh god, that's not good.
What do you mean?
The rate at which you're aging... Oh, it doesn't matter. Everyone, help Tim up. We need to get to the live goods section of this place.
What were you going to say, Doctor?
It's fine. It doesn't matter.
The doctor begins to leave the group as they help Tim up. Mark also leaves the group and joins the doctor.
What were you going to say to him?
You're the type of person who won't stop asking till he gets an answer, right?
You have me pinned. I'm impressed. Now about Tim.
That temporal must have been a hungry one. You can tell because of how small it was.
Okay. How does that relate to Tim?
Once you have been touched by a temporal, it latches itself onto you as long as you're in its range. It then sucks away your age. Depending on how hungry it is, depends on how quickly it takes your age. Bob obviously didn't get touched by a particularly hungry one, so the rate at which he ages is slower. Tim, on the other hand...
Another wispy pop noise is heard from behind Mark and the doctor. They turn to see Tim being carried by Jessie and Bob. Tim had grown even younger.
He won't survive 2 hours.
Well, the solution is simple then, isn't it? We just need to get him away from this place, in your ship thing.
That's... if we can get there. I wish I had a bit of your hope.
It's this door here, Doctor.
The doctor stops and sees a door to his left. He tries to slide it open. It doesn't budge.
Has anyone got a key for it?
The group look at each other with worried expressions on their faces.
This is perfect. Right, I have to use this then.
He reaches into his pocket and takes out his sonic. He points it at the door. As he's about to press the button, Mark pushes the doctor's hand out of the way.
Don't! Do you know how loud that thing is?
Well then, I better unlock this door quickly then, right?
Mark gives the doctor an uneasy look as the doctor puts the sonic back next to the door. The doctor then suddenly presses the button on the sonic very quickly, creating a loud buzzing sound, which echoed down the corridor. The door clicked open.
See? Nothing happened. In, now.
Everyone rushes to the door, all trying to force their way through. Mark and the doctor watch as everyone gets stuck in the door. They both look down the corridor in panic and see, to their severe disappointment, temporals at the other side of the corridor, rushing their way over to the group. Mark instantly reacts by pushing everyone stuck in the door through, extremely forcefully. They all fall to the ground. Mark and the doctor enter and rush to the back wall of the room, not bothering to close the door since temporals can go through walls. Every member of the group watches in silence as a whole group of temporals pass the room and go back down the corridor where the entire group just was. Once the group was sure the last one had passed the room, they all gave out a huge sigh of relief once more and fell to the ground.
Okay then. Is this the live goods section, Tim?
Yeah, all live goods are kept in those crates over there.
The doctor looked over to the other side of the room. There were two large crates placed next to each other.
So we have a 50-50 shot of guessing the oldest creature.
Or we could just carry them both.
Preferably not. We don't want to cause more trouble for ourselves.
Mark walks over to the closest crate and begins to pry it open.
Wait, you don't want to rush into things. There could be anything in there. It could be dangerous.
By this time, Mark had already pried open the box and had picked up what was inside. It was small and pink. It smiled when it saw the group. Jessie looked at it with cuteness.
Oh, It's a pig.
Mark dropped it in panic. It landed on the floor, surprised, and ran over to Jessie. She didn't really know what to do about it.
Is that thing dangerous?
Do you guys really not know what a pig is?
All of them shake their heads.
We were put on the ship as babies and have always worked here. We don't know anything to do with life. We just deliver.
That's extremely sad. Did they do that due to the overpopulation crisis on New Earth?
That's exactly it. Everyone from our generation was put to work from day zero.
That's sick. How could they do something like that?
Doctor, is that thing dangerous?
The doctor looked at Mark. He looked at the pig, terrified, trying his best to keep away from it.
It's completely harmless. Also, it's not the thing we're looking for. It's way too young. It's just a baby pig, so put it back.
Jessie picked up the pig, feeling sorry for it.
We can't do that. Look at it. It was put in the same situation as us, you know, Doctor. Taken away from its home to live its life on this ship. Well, the beginning of its life, anyways.
If you carry it, it'll slow you down.
And pretty fast.
Fine. It'll be safer with us anyway.
Whoa!
Mark, open the other box.
He goes to the other box, slightly more cautious. He slowly opens it and suddenly something jumps out of it and lands on the doctor's face, knocking him to the ground. He begins to wriggle around on the floor as the thing begins to suffocate him. He tries to pull it off, but it's no use. Mark rushes over to help, but again, nothing happens. He tries tugging from several different angles, but the creature stays stuck on. That was until Mark grabbed a knot of the creature's thin hair. The creature fell limp as he did this, and Mark lifted the creature up, making it visible to the group. It was small and purple all over. The overall shape of the creature matched a monkey quite well. It had a thin body, arms and legs that looked like they could be snapped by a touch. Its head was out of proportion to its body. It was large and its mouth protruded out of the sides of its face. Being extremely wide, yellow teeth showed through the gaps between the lips. Its eyes, although closed, were also extremely large. Its forehead was constantly creating an angry, creased expression. There was a tiny tuft of thin, white hair on top of the creature. In this tuft was a knot which Mark was holding onto.
Doctor, what's this thing then?
Oh yeah. I'm completely fine, thanks for asking. I only got suffocated by a bundle of stink.
Mark brought it close to his nose and smelt it. He took it away when he realised the doctor was right about the smell.
I have no clue what that thing is. The two things I do know about it are it hates me, and it gets knocked out when you grab that weird knot on its head.
Mark looked at the doctor proud.
Yes, well done for figuring that out, Mark.
So, is that the distraction then? Can we go?
Yes, we can. Although, I'm pretty sure the temporal can only detect prey when it's conscious.
Meaning?
Meaning? We need to somehow wake that thing up.
Can't we just run to your ship and fly off?
No. They'd be able to tell that there's a sudden change in age potential. Basically, they can tell when we leave.
So distracting them will make them not realise?
Hopefully. Let's just focus on getting back to my ship first. We'll work things out from there. Bob, do you think you can guide us to where you first saw me?
Yeah, I don't have a good feeling about this.
The doctor gets up and the group exit the live storage room. Bob leading this time. They take a right down the corridor, trying to go as quickly as they can. Thankfully for them, the corridor was void of temporals. They took another turn down the corridor, and they saw a stretch of the corridor the doctor recognised. He then took the lead, being able to see some rubbish in the middle of the corridor. This rubbish had obviously come from the cupboard the doctor had landed in. They turn into the cupboard, and the group comes face to face with the TARDIS. No one reacted to it. Actually, the feeling in the air was more of disappointment, probably due to the box's small size.
This is it. The thing that will get us out of here.
That's right.
He turned to Mark. Mark had turned extremely pale. He held his head, squeezing it with pain. He crouched to the ground, dropping the creature.
Mark, are you okay?
He rushed over to Mark.
Does this happen to him a lot?
Just minor headaches, nothing severe like this.
The pain began to well up inside Mark's head. He couldn't hear anyone or anything, just silent whispers of voices inside his head. His head was spinning. He had no idea where he was. Suddenly, he took his hands away from his head and looked upwards. He screamed a scream of intense pain. The doctor quickly covered his mouth, quieting the sound his scream made. There was another scream that was heard from further down the corridor, where they just were, the temporals.
Jessie, you take that thing into the TARDIS. I'll take Mark.
Jessie picked up the purple creature. It was still unconscious. The doctor dragged Mark to the door and unlocked it, dragging Mark inside. No one else joined him, thinking that he was mad to hide inside such a small place.
Fine. You don't have to join me.
The group looked down the corridor and saw, in the distance, a large swarm of temporals quickly approaching them. Everyone opted to enter the TARDIS, and quickly, they pushed and shoved themselves inside and shut the door. Everyone looked around in awe of its giant size inside. The doctor was still covering Mark's mouth. He had seemed to have gotten worse. His face was red, and he was shaking all over the place.
Yes, yes, it's big on the inside, I know. We have bigger fish to fry than that. Since we're inside of the TARDIS, they shouldn't hear us, so it should be fine if I just do this.
He took his hand away from Mark's mouth. He got up, still screaming in extreme pain. He doubled over. Seeing the inside of the TARDIS being so much bigger than the outside just made his headache worse. After a few seconds of being in there, his pain lessened and his scream died down. He crumpled to the floor in a tired slump. The doctor typed on the keyboard.
Well, I've had my fair share of reactions to this place, but I'm pretty sure no one has ever screamed in pain because of it.
So then, how are we going to get out of this?
Bobby boy, staying on the ball. I like it. Well, first things first, we need to try and wake that thing up. I just did a scan of that life form in this TARDIS. Now, it doesn't tell me what that thing is, but it does tell me how old it is.
And?
It's very, very old. 2,456 years old, to be precise.
Perfect, so all we need to do is wake it up, you say?
Exactly. Temporals need conscious food. No one really knows why, but they do.
Bob walks over to Jessie, still holding the creature. He takes it off her and begins to shake it. Its head bobs back and forth as he does this.
Wake up, wake up, wake up!
He shakes harder, but still, nothing.
Doesn't work?
No.
Well, we could wait it out, but we don't really know how long that'll take. Who knows, it might not even wake up.
So what then?
I don't know.
Suddenly, a wispy popping noise sounds near the door. Everyone looks in the sound's direction. It was Tim. He had grown even younger.
Well, we can't wait any longer.
Or what? I know what you're gonna say. You think I'll be dead soon, right? I overheard you telling Mark I wouldn't survive 2 hours. Why not just tell me?
Well, I...
It doesn't matter anymore. I'm gonna die anyway.
He takes the purple creature off of Bob. He then walks towards the door. Mark had now recuperated and saw what he was doing.
Tim, what are you doing?
What does it look like? They need conscious food, right? I'm conscious, so I'm the food. Hopefully this thing I'm holding will distract them for long enough.
Honestly, Tim, that's genius.
Why?
The temporals have kept Tim and that purple creature as one being, since they're so close together. They'll just assume that they're as old as the oldest creature. In this case, they'll think Tim is 2,456 years old. As well as that, They'll think that 2,456-year-old is conscious. You're genius.
Don't you see he's sacrificing his life? All you are doing is getting excited over it.
Oh, sorry, it's not the time.
No.
Sorry.
Something came up on the monitor. It was a view of the TARDIS from outside. It showed the entire swarm of temporals surrounding the TARDIS, aimlessly staring around it.
Well, if Tim does this, then every single one of the temporals will be distracted. He'll be able to get away.
Good point.
Is that all you have to say? He's going to die.
And four of us will survive.
Jeez, this is like the trolley problem.
Is that relevant?
Nope. Sorry.
Tim, are you sure about this?
He held onto the handle of the TARDIS door.
Mark! Everyone! Look at me! I'm getting younger extremely quickly right now. I'm going to die anyway. Except, if I die without distracting them, then everyone else will also die. I have to do this.
Okay.
Well done, Tim. Taking one for the team.
Please. Tim, don't do this.
I have to.
He opens the door slightly and slips his body and the unconscious creature through it. The door shuts again. The doctor looks at the monitor. Everyone is around Jessie, trying to comfort her as she cries, including the pig. Bob notices the doctor looking at the monitor. On it, there is still a view from outside. The doctor was watching Tim approach the temporals.
Take that thing off the screen, it's sick.
Just shut up for a second.
Everyone looks at Bob and the doctor when they hear Bob's outburst. They see what the doctor is doing, and immediately understand his outburst. They all go up to the doctor.
Get it off screen now.
No.
Doctor, you don't think it's a little weird watching someone go to their death?
More than a little weird. It's psychopathic.
The group falls silent as they see Tim. He stops in front of the crowd of temporals, hesitating out of fear before taking one step into the gathering. They swarm around him and the unconscious creature in his hands, and suddenly he fades. The unconscious creature drops to the ground.
Time to go.
So that's it. We're just going to leave him.
Well, what's left of him, yeah.
Really?
Give me a second. Move out the way, will you?
He pushes past Bob and Jessie. Mark watches the doctor pressing seemingly random buttons and switches. The doctor looks up at Mark.
Ah, Mark, perfect positioning. Just press and hold that red button in front of you there. Yeah, that one.
He does as the doctor asks, still watching the doctor run around the console, pressing buttons, switches, levers, and any other type of component attached to this console. Except this time, Mark somehow understood what the doctor was doing.
Oh, I see.
What?
Mark joins the doctor, pressing buttons and switches.
Mark, what are you doing? Stop. This is a very complex machine.
I know that. I just want to help.
The doctor looks at the buttons and levers that Mark is pressing with him. To the doctor's surprise, they seemed to be the right ones. He still felt uneasy about letting Mark help him, but he had more important matters on hand.
Okay. Okay. And...
Now!
The doctor and Mark both flick opposing levers and the TARDIS begins to land. A blurry silhouette begins to fade onto the console platform, becoming more focused as time went on. The doctor watched it as the TARDIS lands. Once the silhouette had gotten as focused as it could get, he looked back at Mark once more. Mark looked back, invigorated.
Okay, and... Three, two, one.
Now!
They both flick the same levers up and the TARDIS begins to take off. Mid-landing, both Mark and the Doctor looked at the silhouette, and in place of it was Tim, standing there, completely confused.
Whoa, what the...
Suddenly, light surrounds Bob and Tim.
Whoa!
The light seemed to sink into the pair's bodies, and when it had finished, the two children were replaced by one old man and someone who looked like they were in their 30s. Everyone was turned back to normal.
Ugh. You okay, Tim?
Yeah, just a few growing pains. That's all.
Tim!
She rushed over to Tim and hugged him tight. The pig rushed over to the pair. Mark and the doctor looked at each other and smiled.
Right then, where are you taking us?
Where's home for you guys?
Bob looked at Tim and Jessie. They were still halfway through their hug, although Tim looked like he wanted to escape from it. He then looked at Mark, who gave him a shrug.
No idea. If I had to call anywhere home, it would be that ship. But that's gone now, ain't it?
Okay then. Anywhere which you have been on a delivery and thought, oh, I would just love to live there.
Not really.
Same here.
Since none of you will pick a place to land.
The doctor walks over to Tim and Jessie. Tim gives the doctor a look of helplessness and hopes that the doctor will help him. But instead, the doctor bends down and picks up the pig. He begins to walk back to the console.
I'll give the pig the choice.
I would like to see you try.
Yeah, it's not like you can communicate with it.
No, I can't. Although, I did try going to pig calling classes in my 14th incarnation. I don't recommend that. The noises get real annoying after a couple of days. Anyway, I won't communicate with the pig, but the TARDIS will.
How?
Like this.
He places two of the pig's hooves on the two metal pads on the console and it makes a noise. He places the pig on the floor and then flicks a lever.
Take a look.
Bob walks towards the door. It was blocked by Jessie still hugging Tim. Bob pushed them apart.
Out of my way!
Hey!
Thank you, Bob. I thought I was gonna die just then.
The doctor follows Bob. Bob opens the door and a dull blue light streams into the room along with a light gust of wind. Bob steps out.
Jessie, I think that's quite enough hugging for one day. If you want to hug something, just hug the pig. Anyways, have a look outside.
Jessie picked up the pig who had run beside her. She followed Tim out.
Mark, you coming?
Yeah, one second. Sorry, I've never been free from that place. Ever.
Understandable. I can't help but feel a sense of deja vu. Weird.
The doctor steps out, leaving just Mark in the TARDIS. He takes a deep breath and begins to head out. As he does so, the TARDIS makes a harsh noise. It scared him and made him rush out of the box faster.
Nice of you to join us, Mark.
Mark looked around. They were in a desert. In the distance was a small village. Its coloration matched to the orange coloration of the desert. The sky was a dull green and, shining through it, was a large blue sun. Everyone looked around in awe at this new planet.
Where are we?
Dojon. Pretty close to where your ship was, actually. I'd say your ship was about 3 light years that way.
He pointed into the sky behind the TARDIS.
We travelled 3 light years just like that.
You seem to have got the gist of it.
How did you do it, Doctor?
Save you? Well, just before the temporals were about to kill you, I materialized the TARDIS around you, taking you from the outside world with the temporals to inside the TARDIS. This made the temporals think that you'd been killed since you'd been undetected by them when you entered the TARDIS. Then all we had to do was fly away undetected. When we were far enough away from the temporals, their link to you and Bob was lost, so you reverted back to normal. This was all obviously done with Mark's help.
I didn't understand a word you said, Doctor. But thank you.
Why did the pig just come here, Doctor?
Where did you pick up your last delivery?
Tim?
Tim turned around after looking at the landscape.
Oh, the last pickup point, Dojon.
And did you pick up any live goods while here?
Yes, one package. Why?
There's your answer, Bob. This is where the pig is from. I guess it just wanted to go back home.
All of that soppy stuff annoys me. Anyway, I'm going to find a place to live down in that village. Anyone joining me?
I will.
Same.
How about you, Mark?
You guys start walking. I'll catch up to you.
Okay, see you there.
They walked down the sandy hill and towards the distant village. The Doctor and Mark stand in silence for a few seconds.
So, How did you know how to fly the TARDIS?
What? Oh, that? I just kind of knew. The layout is similar to the HS transmission, the delivery ship.
So that was your job. Were you the pilot?
The secondary pilot, yes.
Interesting. You know, I wouldn't mind having a little poke around the ship. I mean, once the temporals have gone, obviously.
They stand in silence once again, just taking in the sandy view.
So, what are you going to do after this?
I have something to do.
Oh, what's that?
Well, you know what? I can't remember. How strange. I swear it was really important. I'll remember soon.
Well, can I come with you then?
I don't want a group too big. Someone already has a pending offer.
So that's a no then?
Yeah, sorry.
Who is this other person? Why weren't they with you today?
They were... I don't remember. Either that or I imagined someone wanted to travel with me. Weird.
So, does that mean there's a spot available?
Yes, that does.
So I can come with you?
Of course. I was getting pretty lonely anyway, so I look forward to your company.
This is great. Hang on.
He turns to the group of Tim, Jessie, and Bob, all now at the bottom of the sand dune. Mark puts his hands around his mouth and takes a deep breath.
Sorry, guys! I'm going with the doctor!
You sure?
Yeah! I will come and visit, though!
Have fun!
Thanks! You too!
Jeez, are you trying to burst my eardrum?
Sorry. I couldn't be bothered to walk all the way down there.
You walk around all day. How are you suddenly not bothered now?
I don't know. Maybe it's because I finally feel free from that job. Anyways, to the TARDIS!
I'm pretty sure that was my line, but okay.
They enter and the doctor closes the door. He looks at Mark, who is pulling the happiest face he has ever pulled.
I feel like I'm home.
Good to hear.
The doctor walks up to the console. Suddenly, the TARDIS makes the same harsh noise of pure anger as before. The pair jump at the noise.
Oh, I don't think she likes me.
The doctor looks up, supposedly looking at the TARDIS. He was concerned for her. He stroked the central column as Mark sat down in the red chair. The doctor then pulled a large lever on the console, and the TARDIS began to take off.